Welcome to the GFT podcast, Your Immutable Future. I'm David Creer, and this week I'm very happy to be joined by Jacqueline Kwok, Digital Assets Head of ESG. So welcome to the show, Jacqueline. It's great to have you here, and certainly an interesting area to be speaking about.
Likewise, thank you so much for having me, David. It's a great privilege to be on here.
ESG investing, so environmental, social, and governance investing, has been, taking off in the last couple of years. And I think now Bloomberg said that by the end of 2021, in one of their reports they did earlier this year, potentially worth like $53 trillion, the investments. So why do you think it's getting so much traction this year? What do you think is causing that rise in popularity?
I think there are a few elements that contribute to the rise of ESG investing, as buzzwordy as that sounds. So on one hand, I think everyone, meaning humans on Earth, are starting to see the actual environmental impact of climate change. You see the wildfires across Europe and as well as the Pacific West Coast of the United States. You start to see, lots of abnormal weather patterns that, force us to rethink, there is an impact on climate change. Second of all, I think there has been more data that support the fact that there is long-term value and superior risk-adjusted returns in investments that focus in sustainability or ESG. So when you add the data, when you add those two together, it creates a pretty favorable environment for investors to look into this in a more serious manner, especially investors that care more about long-term value. One more point to kind of drill in this point is that it is, for large asset managers specifically, it is difficult to, diversify away systemic risk or climate risk. And the really only choice is to kind of have a higher investor engagement. So you see more people engaged. And when people are engaged, and by people, I mean investors, when investors are more engaged, I think they're more outspoken about it. And therefore, you see a rise in popularity with data that backs up the fact that ESG investing is better for the long term.
Yeah, that makes more sense. I mean, the more data you have, the more you can see the benefits, and it's kind of clear that the effects of having all the ESG data tracked not impacting people's profits. In fact, it's probably the opposite way around. So that's a really interesting point. And think about data and about how to prove that data regarding the trade is environmental or social or governmentally sound. I mean, that requires like a pretty strong source of truth, and it kind of points to solutions like DAML and DLT. So how do they provide increased auditability in the ESG?
So I think what DAML provides is a framework in building distributed applications that can be deployed on technologies such as distributed ledger technologies. Another word for distributed ledger technologies, or DLT, is blockchain. And when people think these words, they think transparency and having an immutable audit trail, which is very important in maintaining the data integrity of information, new data streams that feed into financial assets specifically that require, data to ensure accountability, especially in the sustainable finance space.
So I know that because of that, DAML and digital assets have been working on some very exciting projects, including some with GFT that are just starting to see light at the moment, such as the work that we are doing with the Bank of International Settlement and a bunch of banks in the Hong Kong region, which more details will be published quite soon. So I'm assuming that you have done other work in this area. I'm pretty sure that from our conversations you definitely have. But can you give us an insight into some of these other projects and what has made them so successful?
Absolutely. I mean, first of all, we're very excited about this project that we're doing with the Bank for International Settlements, their innovation hub in Hong Kong, in partnership with Hong Kong Monetary Authority, or HKMA, where digital asset is providing the development framework for using building applications on blockchain, and GFT delivering all of this to actually bring this vision to life. So to kind of add a little bit of color to this project, it's really a green bond tokenization and issuance platform that allow for retail investors to invest. So this is pretty powerful because it is difficult to service retail investors just purely based on the number of investors that one would have to service. So imagine being a consumer, like a retail investor, an individual, being able to open up an app and be able to invest in a specific bond and be able to track the data that this project is producing, making sure that the money that you've invested actually goes towards the project, the intended purpose of the project, which I think is very powerful. And this is something that blockchain and smart contracts aimed, as well as Internet of Things, aim to solve, so that the bond issuance process, traditionally has been pretty cumbersome and manual, can be automated using smart contracts, everything tracked on the blockchain, making the life cycling of this bond more efficient, as well as having a single source of truth on the blockchain to ensure, ESG reporting and the data integrity of that. A little bit more on DAML is that with transparency, which is a tricky word because not everybody should see everything on the blockchain, where a lot of public blockchain infrastructures force investors, issuers alike to see the same information, but this is often not in everybody's best interest, whereas a DAML-driven solution allows for transparency at the right level so that different market participants are able to see what they need to know only.
Personally, I also think that these types of workflows, I get the feeling that they are really designed for these kind of like private consortiums and kind of DAML workflows. I know that there is some work to do this kind of stuff on public chains as well, but I think that the privacy of the individuals and the fact that individual companies and individual banks and, as you said, regulators, for example, want to be able to keep control of their data really points to this more granular use of smart contracts to be able to really understand who owns what data and when, and also that it shouldn't necessarily be in the public realm. And I think there's a discussion that's kind of open at the moment, but I think that the solution that we're looking at with BIS is going in that direction. I think that's the right way to go with this particular area.
Absolutely. And I realized that I didn't answer your question about some of the other projects that we're working on. So maybe I can address that a little bit beyond this green bond. It's just a very exciting opportunity. And I think it's difficult to tie all those things together across Internet of Things, blockchain and smart contract. And with the help of GFT, we're actually able to bring that to light. So I'm just very excited about this. There's another type of emerging asset class that is definitely tied to the ESG space, which is the rise of carbon assets, carbon offsets as a separate asset class. And digital asset with DAML is able to service clients such as Expansive in order to bring that to light, where Expansive is providing a platform, a trading platform for such assets and being able to marry the data from carbon offsets to trading activity, which I think is also quite exciting. A similar use case, but a different asset class.
Yeah, and I think it's so important to be able to automate your carbon offset trading and buying and selling, and obviously for the people that are selling carbon offset, but also for the for the major companies that are buying carbon offsets, such as the the technology providers who need to offset their data centers, having these kind of platforms where they can trust in the technology that underpins them, be that DAML, be that Expansive, be that something that GFT builds, is super important for them. And having an enterprise platform where they can that they can trust in is important. So I suppose we've spoken a little bit about what we're doing at the moment and, you know, where we are so far. Maybe, you know, like last question before we wrap up is, where do we think that things will be in the future? So in the future, will ESG trading be ubiquitous in the sense that all trades will need to be ESG rated? I think there was one exchange in the US that was saying that most, all of their trades that they were going to trade in the coming years would need to have an ESG rating. But are we going to see ESG moving to becoming the new norm, or is it going to be something that's going to be living alongside traditional trading in the long term? I mean, it's just obviously it's an opinion, but I'd be interested in hearing your opinion on this.
Well, I might be slightly biased because I think that in order for us to have a habitable planet to live on, we do have to turbocharge a lot of these efforts. And capital markets is a great way to accelerate certain efforts because projects that actually help solve climate crisis, as well as companies that care about the social impact of their whatever it is that they're doing in terms of taking into consideration their employees as well as client interests and providing a governance structure to make sure that, you know, this actually happens. I think that will all be necessary for all parties involved to jump on board, if you will. With that said, this is definitely a long-term vision. Let's be very realistic about this. I think this big change will take some time to fully realize. I certainly hope that ESG ratings, first of all, are clarified in what that means. And you know, governance boards such as the SASB, the Sustainable Accounting Standards Board, I think, is able to actually create a set of standards that's similar to accounting standards, allowing companies as well as investors to have a set of standards that you can work towards, having scorecards that you can work towards. So until that really happens, which I really don't think is something that can be achieved in maybe 2 years, I hope so. But I think that when all of that is clarified, which is step one, then you will start to see a further acceleration in all assets having an ESG rating, because that now that there's data to prove that there is superior returns from a long-term risk-adjusted standpoint, you're able to continue down that path. But this is still the beginning.
Yeah, and I think as you said before as well, the, you know, the turn of events in the climate this year and the report that we've seen over the last year, saying that, you know, we're very close to the tipping point, if not all kind of gone past that tipping point, will also hopefully be a call of action to governments and regulators to provide, you know, to create standards groups and to be able to enforce this kind of thing in the long term. But it's a slow moving machine, as you said. So I kind of agree with that. But I think in the future, these kind of ratings, however they will probably become the norm. And I think that's the right, you know, that's the right direction to go in. I think we do have to think about all of these elements. And hopefully, you know, a lot of this will be, you know, trading in general will be underpinned by DLT technology, I would see. I think there's a big role for DAML and for GFT in that future as well.
Absolutely. I think with new different types of asset classes that require lots of data, good data, you do need to employ better scalable technologies that provide better data governance in order to make, you know, data informed decisions.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So I think we're almost out of time. So so I'd just like to say thank you very much for coming onto the show today. Jacqueline, it's been a real pleasure speaking to you. And to all of those people listening in at home, thank you to you too. Please also check out digitalasset.com, which you'll find information about DAML and also the work that they've been doing in this area. And also just keep an ear out for the upcoming news from ourselves at GFT about what we're doing from BIS and the press releases and the final report that will be coming a little bit further down the track, and the work that we'll be doing in this area as well with DAML in the not too distant future. So thank you all for listening in. And thank you very much again, Jacqueline, for this very interesting podcast.
Thank you for having me, David.